To summarize, a practical approach to hypoxemia involves thinking about the normal journey of oxygen, which starts with oxygen acquisition, then the oxygen's journey to the alveoli, and then diffusion into the bloodstream. A lesion at any of these sites can lead to hypoxemia. The way you can make progress immediately. Welcome back, clinical problem solvers. It's Prof. Rez, a clinician in Chicago who loves learning and teaching. This channel is purely dedicated to understanding medicine, and it's only for your education. Today, we're going to speak about a practical approach to hypoxemia. Huge shout out to Robbie Geha, who created this brilliant approach. How many of you have been taught the five pathophysiologic mechanisms to hypoxemia? I will tell you that when you evaluate a patient at the bedside, those mechanisms are not practical. So let's talk about a practical approach. Though, to understand the approach to hypoxemia, first we have to understand the normal way that oxygen goes from the environment into your bloodstream. And this consists of three components. Number one is oxygen acquisition from the environment. Part two is oxygen's journey to the alveoli. And part three is oxygen actually diffusing from the alveoli into the bloodstream. So pathology at any one of these sites can lead to true hypoxemia. But because we like to prioritize the frequency and base rate of disease, we're first going to talk about pathology in this bucket. So what can happen at the level of the alveoli that leads to true hypoxemia? Well, it can be filled with a substance, or it can collapse. So what kind of substances can fill the alveoli? H2O. This can result in cardiogenic pulmonary edema or non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema like acute respiratory distress syndrome. White blood cells. For example, pneumonia or aspiration pneumonitis or hypersensitivity pneumonitis. And even red blood cells. For example, someone with diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. Other substances like protein and cancer can also infiltrate the alveoli, leading to hypoxemia. When the alveoli collapse, this is referred to as atelectasis. And of course, if you get enough collapse of alveolar units, this will impair gas exchange, leading to true hypoxemia. We'll talk about this more as we discuss the journey. So the journey starts with oxygen entering the airway. So if someone has an upper airway obstruction, for example, from angioedema, anaphylaxis, or even a foreign object, this can lead to hypoxemia. Now, there's other pathology in the airway that can lead to hypoxemia. This includes COPD, asthma, and bronchiectasis. We've already talked about the alveoli as we're following the path of oxygen. What about the parenchyma? Well, if you have interstitial lung disease, which has its own differential diagnosis, this can lead to hypoxemia. Now, diseases at the site of the pleura, pleural effusion, pneumothorax, hemothorax, pathology at the level of the diaphragm and chest wall can all lead to hypoxemia through collapsing the alveoli. Okay, this is where we're going to incorporate our DDX equation, which is localization times time course. How are we going to localize the site of pathology in the setting of hypoxemia? The lung exam. Note that the lung exam and response to oxygen therapy are available to you ASAP to make progress in localization. Then we'll incorporate the time course to prioritize our DDX. So if someone has substances filling their alveoli, on examination, you're gonna auscultate crackles. If someone has fluid in the pleural space, they're gonna have decreased breath sounds and dullness to percussion. Now let's say someone has stridor or secretions or even edema of their lips, you're gonna prioritize an upper airway obstruction. Now, how can we use time course? Let's just use alveoli as one example. If the patient went from normal to abnormal like that, well, you'll prioritize maybe a phenomenon like aspiration pneumonitis or flash pulmonary edema. Now, let's make our way from the alveoli to the vessel. So what can happen at the vessel that can lead to hypoxemia? A patient can have a pulmonary embolism or a shunt. And the shunts come in two flavors, cardiac shunts and pulmonary shunts. Literally, when someone has a shunt, they have mixing of deoxygenated blood with oxygenated blood, leading to hypoxemia. So now when we come to our equation here, what will the lung exam be in someone with a PE or shunt? It'll be normal. It'll be normal. So if someone has a normal lung exam in hypoxemia, you have to consider a vascular problem like a PE and a shunt. What about response to oxygen therapy? You see, patients with pulmonary emboli will respond to oxygen therapy, but if you have a shunt, you won't get much of a response to supplemental oxygen because that deoxygenated blood keeps mixing with the oxygenated blood. Now, I have to share one caveat here. We can't assume that our lung exam is 100% accurate. So sometimes our lung exam may be normal, but then the x-ray shows some kind of abnormality that brings us back to this bucket of our differential diagnosis. So now let's make our way to oxygen acquisition. You see, it doesn't matter if your airway is patent, if your vessels are patent, if you don't actually acquire oxygen from the environment. So in someone who has a low respiratory rate, for example, someone who is receiving opioid therapy or has used heroin, they may have a low respiratory rate. If you're not taking in oxygen, guess what? You can have hypoxemia. Or someone with chest wall abnormality or obesity, like obesity hypoventilation syndrome, that too can lead to hypoxemia. Less common is high altitude can lead to a low partial pressure of inspired oxygen, leading to hypoxemia. Here's the beauty. For this category of low respiratory rate and just supplemental oxygen, response to oxygen, you'll see an improvement in the hypoxemia, just a small amount of oxygen. Also, here's where the ABG is going to be very helpful, because these patients, they do not have an increase in the alveolar arterial oxygen gradient, unlike the other categories of hypoxemia. To summarize, a practical approach to hypoxemia involves thinking about the normal journey of oxygen, which starts with oxygen acquisition, then the oxygen's journey to the alveoli, and then diffusion into the bloodstream. A lesion at any of these sites can lead to hypoxemia. The way you can make progress immediately at the bedside is through a lung exam and response to oxygen therapy. Patients with pleural parenchymal pathology will have an abnormal pulmonary exam. Patients with a vascular abnormality will have a normal pulmonary exam. And if they don't respond to supplemental oxygen, you're dealing with a shunt. And patients who have a low respiratory rate may have other exam findings, but they generally respond pretty quickly to oxygen therapy.